I'm not used to preaching to the converted, so it's a little different. To be memorable, you don't have to be eternal. So I won't speak for too long, and I feel like a total fool. I feel like one of those chickens that are being constantly, because that was, you shared one of the most honest and profound talks, insights, emotional sharing that I think has ever been given over in this synagogue. So we're very humbled, and it was very, very brave and very honest. And you are truly an inspiration to me and everybody in this room. Okay, for the joke, because I don't want to put people into a sermon-induced coma. And if I slip into like all day mode, just throw something, because I you know, we have this very interesting hipster show over here, and I find it better just to speak all the time because it's a little boring the holidays. I'm bored and I'm leading it, so I talk a lot to try and keep people entertained. So if I slip into like, you know, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, just throw something at me. Okay, we'll start with a joke. It's not easy to be a rabbi, Rina, and pay the bills. We all have, yeah.
Do you mind if you say any Hebrew words you mind translating for Sita?
I'm very, very ADD, so I'll try.
Okay.
I'll try.
That's okay.
Attention deficit disorder. Okay. Okay, so Sita?
Yes.
Back in the Sita.
Arkansas.
Beautiful. Arkansas?
Yeah.
Like Clinton. Okay. Sorry. Okay, so it's not easy to be a rabbi and pay the bills. We all have our many jobs and side jobs. And one of my many, many jobs, I work as the rabbi to Long Island College Hospital. I did until they fired me, but they fired everyone because they're closing and becoming a condo. That's what happens in Brooklyn. They take hospitals and make them into condos. So my job was, I used to go and meet the patients, deal with their needs, physical, spiritual, existential. I would go like sort of 10 hours a week, though as a Chabad rabbi, I went very often a lot more. I took it very seriously. So the story goes, I walk in the room theater one day. There are three guys in three beds with three different degrees of injuries and ailments. I go over to the first guy, I introduce myself, and the rabbi, how can I help you, what happened? It's like an open crowd over here. I can go there, right?
Yeah.
Same bed? You say three men in the same bed?
Three men in three beds. We have that too in this school, but I think Rebbitz and Trey paved the path. I like Trey. You paved the path. Okay, so I go over to the third guy. I introduce myself. I'm the rabbi. What happened? How can I help you? He said, Rabbi, have I got a story to tell you? I said, tell me the story. It's honest. That can be. Okay, so Rabbi, I never like totally trusted my wife. And I come home one day, and coming from the bedroom is a foreign aftershave. Tells me I like to wear Izumayaki. I can smell protruding out of the master bedroom, Calvin Klein CK1. So Rabbi, I'm fuming. I run in. I open up the closet. There's no one there. I open up. I'm looking under the the bed. No one there. I see hanging onto the balcony of the bedroom. It's a guy, he's holding on for his life. So Rabbi, I'm fuming. I ran to the kitchen. I take out a hammer. I start to smash away. He falls 32 stories to the ground. He landed in a bush. He got up. It's a miracle. He brushed off the leaves. Not a scratch on him. So Rabbi, I was fuming. I ran to the kitchen. I slept, pulled out the refrigerator, and threw it onto his head. In my agony, I had a heart attack. Here I am. I said, oy vey, before Shalema, have a nice life. I'm getting the hell. I go over to the next guy, and the rabbi, how can I help you? What happened? Guys, rabbi, I just don't get it. You know, I work as a window cleaner. It's a smart crowd. I'm cleaning the windows. I slip. I'm holding on to the balcony for my life. I see my savior coming in to help me. Meshuggah grabs a hammer. He's smashing it away. I fall 30. I land in a bush, I get up, I put my sugar nut, madman, throws the refrigerator onto my head, and here I am. I said, Oy vey, have a nice life. I go over to the third guy, I'm the rabbi, how can I help you? What happened? I said, Rabbi, guy hiding in the refrigerator. I guess, you know, we all come from different places and spaces. Unlike the Revitson's journey, and unlike perhaps everybody in this room, I did not grow up religious, Hasidic, observant, Orthodox, Chabad. For want of a better word, I grew up normal. I'm from Manchester, England, if anyone's been to Manchester. Famous literary giant Mark Twain visited Manchester, and he wrote in his travel log he'd like to spend the remaining days of his life in Manchester. And he went on to write because he feels like it'll make the transition to death. It's my hometown. And for me growing up, religion was spiritual value. For me, religion was something that others needed to get answers to existential questions in life that had no answers. My religion growing up was pop culture. I used to work as a film location manager in the north of England on all sorts of movies that I guess none of you would know. I worked on some of the Bond movies, a lot of Manchester Field. So that was never for me part. I worked on the building that none of you would know about Spice World, starring the Spice Girls. A lot of different books in the full Monty watching this movie. I was behind the camera, not fully. Long way. Many stories, but primarily my foot. It was